Hi, everyone. I hope everyone can hear me. I'll just wait for that confirmation and then we can get started. Oof. I'm excited and nervous, and I have a lot to share today. Oh, shoot. I just spilled juice on myself. I don't know if I'm going to be able to keep up with chat the whole time. Probably not, but I will be checking in periodically. Amy W., I'm sorry that your son is in the hospital. We'll keep him in our thoughts. Hi. All right, great. So I have two presentations for today. I couldn't decide which one to go with, and I've been kind of all over the place lately. Just a lot of like personal stuff, and also just coming back from Colorado and just simmering and everything that happened. So I definitely have a lot to say, and I don't know where to begin. So I have two presentations. One is concerning harassment and the Honor Network that I've seen some creators starting to talk about. So I wanted to share my findings with you. And the second one is about the evidence and the investigation in the Watts case. And obviously like next steps. So which one did you guys wanna hear first? So put in one if you wanna hear the Honor Network stuff, or two if you wanna go straight to the case. Or three, you don't care. Oh, crap. Okay. This was a bad idea. Okay, so I'm seeing two. All right. I'm seeing a lot of people going with two. And one. They really go hand in hand, to be honest, but I was hoping to get the Honor Network out of the way first because it's the shorter one. So I feel like by the time we're done with the Watts one, I will be like too triggered to do anything else. Yeah, let's get the shorter one over with. Okay. So let me share my screen. All right. Whew. Okay, so I'm not going to be seeing chat a lot, but I hope that this is, I need like another screen to watch what you guys are seeing because I can't see anything. I'm sorry, I'm completely like disorganized right now, even though I had like 6 hours to prepare. All right. So I'm going to start off this presentation. I named it Dishonor, and the reason why I named it Dishonor is because obviously some of the people that are volunteering for this organization have absolutely no like respect, let alone honor. So let me just say that everything that is contained in this presentation is from Facebook and from YouTube, both of which are public platforms. So I am not doxing anyone, just in case someone wants to get all in their panties about it. And I think that's a beautiful part about accountability on social media, which is what we don't have enough of and we need more of. You're gonna be held accountable for the shit you say. So there you go. All right, so you know how I roll. Definitions. Harassment is the act of systematic and or continued unwanted and annoying actions of one party or a group, including threats and demands. The purposes may vary, including racial prejudice, personal malice, an attempt to force someone to quit a job or grant sexual favors, apply illegal pressure to collect a bill, or merely gain sadistic pleasure from making someone anxious or fearful. Such activities may be the basis for a lawsuit if, due to discrimination based on race or sex, a violation of the statutory limitations on collection agencies, blah, blah, blah. Okay, so that's the definition, and keep that in mind as we go through this presentation. Okay, I added also cyber stalking, and that includes cyber stalking can take many forms and includes harassment, embarrassment, and humiliation of the victim, emptying bank accounts or other economic controls, such as ruining the victim's credit score, harassing family, friends, and employers to isolate the victim, scare tactics to instill fear, and more. Now, in this context, victim includes it, the victim is the person who is being harassed. So this has nothing to do with the case right now. This is just the definition. All right. Defamation. Defamation is a statement that injures a third party's reputation. The tort of defamation includes both libel, which are written statements, and slander, which are spoken statements. The elements of defamation. The plaintiff must show four things. One, a false statement perpetrating to be fact. Two, publication or communication of that statement to a third person. Three, fault amounting to at least negligence. And four, damages or some harm caused to the person or entity who is the subject of the statement. And some places, I mean, defamation is a criminal offense. So some explanation continues. Some statements of facts are so egregious that they will always be considered defamatory. Such statements are typically referred to as defamation per se. These types of statements are assumed to harm the plaintiff's reputation without further need to prove that harm. Statements are defamatory per se where they falsely impute to the plaintiff one or more of the following things: criminal offense, a loathsome disease, matter incompatible with his business, trade, profession, or office, serious sexual misconduct. Okay, so it's automatic defamation when someone accuses you of a criminal offense. Okay. And it's not true, obviously. So that's, in this case, you do not have to prove harm. So for example, saying that I forged emails with law enforcement, that would be a criminal offense. And I was accused of that criminal offense. And I can easily prove that that is not true. So therefore, I have a case for defamation per se. That's an example. So then actual malice, in a legal sense, actual malice has nothing to do with ill will or disliking someone and wishing him harm. Rather, courts have defined actual malice in the defamation context as publishing a statement while either knowing that it is false or acting with reckless disregard for the statement's truth or falsity. Now, I can't tell you how much evidence of this there is out in YouTube land with certain individuals. So I just thought it would be very useful so that we're all on the same page in terms of what the definitions are, because it sounds like a lot of people are very misinformed. And I don't blame them, because a lot of the trolls that pose as volunteers are actually from different countries and have no clue about the US standards and about the law in the US. So they're just running around being completely reckless in their statements, not caring, not doing their research, just being plain old reckless. All right. Truth is an absolute defense against defamation. So that's pretty self-explanatory, right? So now let's get in. We're going caring. Okay, let me light up my cigarette first. So, the Honor Network. Megan Jade did a video recently about this, and that's great. So you can watch hers as well for more context. But basically, we were introduced to the Honor Network by Lambert. I don't know his first name. And that Lambert is a Rusek's attorney. And in their statement, they said that the Honor Network reached out to the Rusek's because they wanted to help with the harassment and bullying. The problem that I have with this, even with the very first conference that Frank Rusek did in front of the Watts house, when he said that they would be getting death threats, whatever, like, I have never seen any of that. So I would love to be referred to places or people or statements that were made that were harassment, bullying, threatening, violent, whatever. Okay, so I'm still waiting around for that. But anyway, so they say that the Honor Network reached out to them. So I did some research on the Honor Network. And the Honor Network is actually a pretty awesome organization in theory, right? It started by Mr. Posner, who is the father of a victim of the Sandy Hook shooting. And also, Mr. Posner, along with other families of the children that were murdered in that school, began being harassed online by what's called hoaxers, or what they call hoaxers. Now, hoaxers is a very specific term, and it includes a very specific group of people. And hoaxers are individuals such as Alex Jones, who have very, very outrageous theories about the government and what the government is willing to do or doing in order to take away the Second Amendment from American citizens. Meaning, in this context, in the context of the Sandy Hook shooting, Alex Jones had this show called InfoWars, and it was on YouTube 24/7, and he would spew ridiculous theories about Sandy Hook never happened, that no one died at Sandy Hook, that everybody was hired, they were actors, that everything was orchestrated by whatever, like the deep state or whatever. And so, of course, Alex Jones was pretty popular, especially with, like, in America, at least, with like, the extreme right-wing whatever group, which is now political, because that's the problem. Like, this goes into politics. And so anyway, so then, of course, Alex Jones encouraged and also, perpetrated these false narratives about Sandy Hook, and it has fueled like an entire online community and who believe in this to be fact. So I can only imagine what it was like for Mr. Posner to go on the internet and see people talking about a photograph of his son and him and saying that it was photoshopped, that it's not real, that, you know, just ridiculous. They doxed all of the family members, the surviving family members of the children. It was relentless. Okay, so hoaxers are people who believe that the government is after you and they want to take your guns away. Okay, and they believe that all mass shootings are perpetrated and orchestrated by this underground part of the government called the deep state. And it's all just fake, right? So those are hoaxers. keep that in mind. Now, January 16th, the Honor Network website posts an article talking about how they're scrubbing the internet of harassing posts, helping the family of Shanann Watts. I'm still waiting for those posts, by the way, but okay, according to the definition, right? Because what we're doing actually is discussing, we're discussing a criminal case that has captured the attention of not just the United States, but worldwide, because a pregnant woman and her two children were murdered, all right? And one person is sitting in jail, and there's a list of unanswered questions in this case. This case is not black and white. This case is not Sandy Hook happened versus it didn't happen. All right? This case is a botched investigation. Okay, let me get off my soapbox. We'll get into the case later. Let me just finish with this. All right? So what basically happened is Lambert said that Honor approached them in the press conference. I later contacted the Honor Network as part of my research. I emailed them through their website, and I asked them to remove a video made by Martin Dehan in which I am accused of being something akin to a Nazi. Right? That my family perpetrated genocides and whatnot. Completely ignorant bullshit. All right. So I contacted them and I said, you know, I lived through the Bosnian genocide. Therefore, I am a victim of a mass event, whatever. And this person is clearly violating not only YouTube terms, but also slander and harassment and defamation, because this person, one of many, is so obsessed with me and Armchair Detective specifically. Now, the reason why I bring up this person is because before the Honor Network came around, there was a group of these trolls that were just following Armchair Detective around wherever he went, okay? So no matter what the hell Alan talked about, it didn't matter. They'd be there, they'd call him a scammer, liar, cheater, whatever. Okay, you already know the deal, right? So that little group of trolls somehow got it in their minds that, oh yes, if we join Honor Network as volunteers, we can take the Armchair Detective down. And of course, anyone who's associated with him. That includes myself. And then slowly it like spiraled into, let's just get rid of everyone who talks about the case. And that's not gonna work. Like I'm not gonna stand for that, period. I don't care who you are. But anyway, so let me get back to the story, right? So now this group of these like trolls that follow Armchair Detective around for years, they joined the Honor Network and they somehow established contact with the Rusecks. And I'm not paying attention to chat, so let me see. Okay, no, let's not delete that, please. Let's keep that up. Hold on. I don't know how to undo that, but yeah. Let them talk. Let them call BS. Let them call BS, because I'm not done. All right? So, yeah, no need to time out anyone or delete anything. I really don't care. So let them call whatever the hell they want. I'm putting out the findings of my own investigation, and people can make up their own damn minds. Like, see, I'm not a person that needs to tell people what they need to think, all right? Like, I encourage people to think for themselves, Team Phoenix, okay? So I understand that you don't agree with this, that you call bullshit. That's fine. I'm just showing what I have found, all right? And this isn't even like, this is the tip of the iceberg, y'all. Like, I don't have the nerve or the time or the patience to sit through and put everything out there. So this is just a little bit of everything, all right? Okay, so now we have the trolls and the Rusecks all coming to Honor, asking for harassing posts of the family to be removed, right? So now I'm like, okay, what harassing posts? Let's keep going. For the victims of some of the worst crimes, this is from the Honor Network, from that article. For the victims of some of the worst crimes and mass shootings in the country, the pain doesn't stop after the case is closed. Conspiracy theories, disinformation, and threats made against the families of the victims run rampant online. That's why the family of Shanann Watts said, the family of Shanann Watts said happened to them after her murder. There have been a number of instances of people reaching out to them, threatening them anonymously, said Stephen Lambert, an attorney with Grant and Hoffman Law Firm, who represents the family of Shanann Watts. They say, oh, Chris really wasn't the killer, it was X. Let's stop right there. Is there anything defamatory or threatening or harassing about this statement? Please. I'll wait. My cigarette burned off. That's how amped up I am. Okay. So, or his original confession was the real confession, and Shanann did have a hand at this, or some sort of conspiracy like that, whatever. That kind of stuff bothers them a lot. Okay, so it bothers them, or it's harassing and threatening them. Just because you don't like something on the internet, that doesn't mean that you have the right to get it removed. That's the whole thing with the First Amendment. We're discussing a public case. The first confession is part of a public document of a murder investigation wherein that first confession, by the way, was never ruled out. So when you say that blatant lies that the first confession was real, we don't know that, to be honest with you, because all we have is the confession of a proven certified liar. Okay? So you're saying we're not going to believe Chris in anything that he says except this. So no, I'm saying it now. The first confession was never proven wrong or ruled out. Because why? We'll talk about that later. They go on to say that so the family of Shanann Watts was thrust into the public spotlight when Chris Watts killed his wife and two daughters. A year and a half later, lawyers said Shanann Watts' family still faces threats and conspiracy theories targeting them online. Still waiting for that evidence. All right. They've turned to an organization called Honor Network for Help. Recall that Lambert said that the Honor Network approached them. So right away, we have an inconsistency. And I'm going to go ahead and believe this article because I don't buy for a second that the Honor Network is keeping up with a family annihilator when they're dealing with hoaxers, right? Okay. The Honor Network, so we've got roughly 300 to 400 volunteers active at any given time. We create kind of a mass flagging circle, said whoever this is, a board member with the Honor Network. Just flagging something once or twice doesn't do anything, and you can only flag once on your account. What Lenny created was kind of a group of volunteers that would alert each other when something defamatory was posted, and they would share the link and flag en masse. Okay. She goes on to, or Lambert says, the Honor Network has been immensely and immeasurably helpful when it comes to online bullying and harassment. They not only just assist them in getting some of this material removed from online, but also in healing. Honor Network said, they worked with victims of the Aurora Theater shooting to combat conspiracy theories and disinformation online as well. They also work with victims of online bullying who haven't been a part of a high-profile crime. Okay. Moving on. This is also from the website. 26% of American adults have had untrue information posted about them online, causing emotional anguish, fear, and damage to their personal and professional reputations. Together, through empowerment, education, and advocacy, we can affect change and help to create a safer, more inclusive online experience for all. Help us achieve this goal. Okay. I'm not even going to comment on this because you can see the contradiction in this statement, right? But I do want to clarify one thing, okay? That the actual victims of Sandy Hook and the parents, Mr. Posner, and the rest of the families who have helped start this organization actually are fighting for justice and are actually doing something to put an end to the likes of Alex Jones and like the incel community and things like that. Those are actual dangerous people that hide in dark corners of the internet and perpetuate pain, misinformation, just vile stuff. All you have to do is just Google it. You can see for yourself. It's not necessary for me to talk about that. So that is what this family and the families who were victimized are doing. And I commend them for that. I commend them for that. Actually, I would any day sign up to volunteer for an organization like that. And I have volunteered for many organizations that are nonprofit and are fighting for justice, freedom of speech, and other topics that affect us all. All right, that affect us all as American citizens in the United States of America, but also worldwide. But mind you, this is focused only on the United States, all right? Their goal is to empower victims and their families through education and advocacy. Our goal is to provide education to victims as well as law enforcement, employers, and others who deal with victims of online aggression. And their goal is to also help craft impactful policy and legislative reform that makes the internet a safer, more inclusive place for all. Honor empowers, educates, and advises. That's brilliant, right? It sounds perfect. Now, enter the group that stalks the armchair detective and myself, okay? Now they've learned about this place, right? And now all of a sudden, they are these victims advocates, right? So what they did is they joined the Facebook groups for the Honor Network. And they have their own little Facebook groups where they just, you'll see. But now all of a sudden, these self-proclaimed victims advocates are running around the internet, causing mayhem, feeding not only the Honor Network founders bullshit, but also purposefully misleading them only because they have a personal dislike of Armchair Detective and because Armchair Detective doesn't acknowledge their hissy fits, then we're gonna get the Rusex on board and we're all gonna fight this blah, 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 these hoaxers, right? Of course, I am number two on the hit list only because I will not turn my back on Armchair Detective because what makes you think that I'm going to listen to you without doing my own research, right? That's the whole point of the, if you recall the first part in the definitions where it says that someone has to do some sort of work to establish whether or not a statement is true before they believe it, before they start broadcasting it around. And that doesn't mean confirm what you're saying with your echo chamber trolls. I'm talking to you. doesn't mean that. It means something else. Okay. So let's have a look, please. What a trash bag she is. Someone says he, when they say he, that's armchair, he should be harassed. He's a piece of shit. And then this particular post is asking for the content that's specifically related to harassment, bullying, slander, whatever the hell else they're looking for, right? Of course, Mr. Posner is not going to sit there and watch 500 YouTube videos that Armchair Detective did, or that I did for that matter. So none of this material that these trolls are giving them is actually reviewed. All right. So basically, in my, from my understanding, in just reading the groups, it's just based off of the word of these trolls and the Rusek family who are being fed by the trolls. All right. So Mr. Posner is just going along with it. And he's there for content removal, recall. He's looking for hoaxers. And mind you, just a side note, there's still a lot of those hoaxers around today. They still continue to say that mass shootings are fake, that whatever the hell, you know. So they are busy. Every day they're busy taking these people down. And to be fair, they do an excellent job because they've gotten so many websites removed. They've gotten freaking Alex Jones removed from YouTube. He had a 24-hour shit show on YouTube every day, live streaming, full of BS, okay? They got him off. They got him off of YouTube. So that shows you that what these people are doing is effective. And it gets it done. They're serving their purpose. So then tell me why after 2 years, I'm still sitting here ranting on this freaking video and AD's ranting on his videos. And now we're adding more people to the list. Now they're like, let's get this Megan J. Let's get Mia. Let's get Critical K. Let's get Mensa. Let's get everybody that we don't like. You know what? Fuck it. Let's get everybody who talks about the case, period. No, that's not going to happen. Here we go. They're making a hit list. So let's read. The reason why I did not redact these names is because these people are on Facebook, which is a public platform, like I said in the beginning, and they're also YouTube creators. So none of this should be a surprise to them, all right? Because they love making videos about this. Look at. Who are these people? They made a hit list. Look, Cindy and Jamie Watts are on the hit list. Excuse me, but the last time I checked, Cindy and Jamie Watts are just as much victims as are the Ruseks. So where in any sane mind does this make sense? Please, I'll wait. Shannon is on the list. Everybody and their mother is on the list. Organized cyber gang. All right. Look, they have a hit list. Armchair Detective, True Psych Ward, Lady Justice, Set the Record Straight, Mary Marlowe, Audrey Briggs, Tarot Cards for the Soul, Daniel Bishop, Midnight Mistral. Please, I'll wait for you to tell me where these channels are hoaxing or doing whatever the hell, okay? They've made Google Docs. This one in particular, it looked like something out of a freaking movie, okay? Multiple pictures of me, my date of birth, my address, my phone number. My family tree, guys, I'm not exaggerating. My family tree is inside of this document where they dox my 18-month-old nephew. All right. And there's a hit list, or sorry, there's a Google Doc for every single person on the hit list. Let's keep going. This person, hey, Dr. B, by the way, I'm BP from Sunburst, you paranoid stupid bitch. We know who you are, and everything has been forwarded to the correct authorities to deal with your license and what you've done illegally with your company. Have fun, Miss. And then Docs is my last name. Okay. Next, you bitch. You know why we don't like you. AD knows why we don't like him. And neither one of you can have a discussion, your way or the highway. I hate them both, but this doctor bitch, you're going down. By the way, if this spreadsheet on AD exists, I'd like to see it. I can't even read this shit. So if you guys want to come back to it and read it yourselves. Next. This one is looking me up and then crying about being doxxed, all right? I did not dox this woman, first of all. Second of all, hypocrite, okay? Next, we have Miss Valerie, who, I can't even read this shit, but at the end of the day, she wanted to meet me at Frederick Police Department. I was hoping she would show up, but she didn't, so, okay. Of course, just beautiful victim advocacy language, right? I wonder if they taught them that at the training courses. Look at that. Please, I'll wait. I'll wait for you to tell me if this is advocacy. Okay. And then, of course, the Rusecks get involved because you see what shit they're being fed by these so-called advocates. Okay. And then, of course, the Rusecks join in. That woman he talks to is absolutely full of shit. The facility has never heard of her. We checked. Okay, Frankie. Just stop. And then look at Helen. Dr. B, yes! Her name is Natasha, whatever the hell that is, because that's not my name, or the second one. A lot of people are saying she's fake. You just proved it. A professional would never disclose or investigate like she has. It's not their remit to do so. Helen, shut up. Amber, she's not a doctor. There's no sign of her. And so now who's the one seeking out personal information? Okay. And then they ask why they get blocked from platforms. This is why you get blocked, Mr. Rusek Sr. and Mr. Rusek Jr. This is exactly why you get blocked. You and I are both hyper aware of the possible consequences due to other people's actions, specifically putting our information out for public consumption in a threatening way. We maintain our vigilance and what we have done to protect ourselves. And now, mind you, this is coming from Miss Samantha, aka Salty Bitch, right? Who just got done talking all this match. Well, hold on. We didn't even get to her yet. Wait, we're not even there yet. Then here we go. She's really an evil bitch. What is she? Some sort of a refugee in America? She probably lied her way to America, full of bullshit as well. She really is a nasty piece of work. I've had a fight with her just to keep fighting against her. She hates confrontations, just like dickhead AD. I hate confrontation. But I reached out to every single one of these people talking shit, asking them if they needed to see more proof of what they're claiming I'm lying about. And each one of them got their proof, and each one of them twisted it around and completely ignored it and spun it into something. At one point, they said that my diploma is from the quote-unquote old country, that I manufactured it. Okay, let's keep going. Oh, here she is. This one right here. The one that's so vigilant about protecting people, right? Look at. Accusing someone as a crime is automatic defamation, and he's guilty of negligent, like, bitch, please, I can't even read this shit. Okay. But then she goes on from all her, like, righteousness and entitlement. Fucking gypsy wretch, for fuck's sake, where's your pride? She has none. You're right, Samantha. I don't. I don't even know who this is, but she's late on reading this. I've been playing catch up, lady. Got behind with all of my reading. This is awesome, as always. I am so glad you used the word gypsy when talking about Dr. Fake. I have wrote it so many times in my comments and always went back to delete it. She reminds me of a gypsy and how they con anyone they can. They're the biggest crooks anyone would ever meet. And when you interfere with their scam, they are, when you interfere with their scam, they are running. They get very angry to the point they will cause any harm they can to that person. Everyone in that area of town looks down on them like the low down pieces of shit they are, not because of who they are, but because of their actions. Honestly, I've never met a damn gypsy that wasn't after money, trying to con someone out of their hard-earned money. Hell, I just watched an old episode of All in the Family with Archie Bunker. He even said it in one of his episodes, you gotta watch out for those gypsies, LOL. Then we have Carol Cox. Like, at this point, everybody knows Carol. Well, Dr. Brilshi, you hiding from everyone except Maggot. You couldn't get further up his arse if you tried. Why are you so bitter with the world? We saved you and your family. The you abuse the oath doctors take. You and your family don't deserve what we gave you. You make me sick. She's referring to me being a refugee. Why are you scamming the public? You are repeating word for word what's put in the public. Okay. Oh, Carol. Thank you for vindicating us. Yes, we are repeating word for word what is in public domains. Thank you. You're supposed to be a doctor. You've broken every oath. You should be ashamed of yourself. Stop lying, scamming, leeching off the Watts family. Oh, I thought I was leeching the Rusek family. Help me understand that, because the Watts are on the hit list. Remember, they're harassers, they're bullies, they're whatever the F else. Is this how you repay the USA for giving you a safe home and a great education? You make me sick. And we have this piece of work here. I'm not even gonna read this out loud because it's just too vile, but take your time. All right, let's keep going. Now the obsession starts. Bazian bitch has launched merch. Give me a break. They're like on top of me more than I am on myself, if that makes sense. Let me see. Right, here I'm being accused of, like, what does this say? I cannot understand why someone as seemingly intelligent as yourself would risk deportation through your illegal and ultimately vile attacks upon Salty, not to mention teaming up with British con man Vinicombe. Notice that anytime I'm attacked, Vinicombe is not left out of the mix, right? So really, at the end of the day, the problem here is they don't like the armchair detective for whatever reason. And I'm guilty by association, right? So I said, what exactly am I doing that's illegal and grounds for deportation? FYI, I am a legal citizen and I cannot be deported because 10 people on YouTube have an obsession with me. As much as you'd probably love to see that, I'm sorry to disappoint. Her response, indeed. And then later on in this thread, like I said, there's so much more. I don't even have the patience. So later on, someone's like, you should pay attention to her last name. Like, that's supposed to scare me. Okay. Law enforcement do not take kindly to your falsifying of emails. I refer to Frederick Police Department. And then Carol Cox asking for a Baskin. All right. Now, this is me saying that if you ever come across a profile, a video, a channel that is talking shit about Armchair Detective, myself, Menza, Critical Care, whoever the hell is on that hit list, you report them. Let's create our own mass flagging system. Because we actually have some grounds. And my evidence for that is I've reported 3 videos that this idiot just lifted off of Armchair Detective's thing, wherein I talk. And of course, after 3 strikes, she gets shut down and then accuses me of fraudulently removing her channel. Did it ever occur to you, bitch, that maybe you are the one breaking the rules? Because if it was a mistake and if it was fraudulent, you'd have your little channel back now, all right? This one. She's got God knows how many, but these are 2 that I know for sure. And this woman is also responsible for weaseling under a fake account into our moderator chat, recording weeks worth of conversations in the chat. And then she made this little video thinking that she just exposed everything. When really, like, what they did is cherry pick shit. And yes, we make fun of things and we laugh at things. And so that's, you know, we don't stalk. Team Phoenix, please have a seat and let me finish, okay? I didn't say anything about you, did I? You're there. You're an overseer. You know what's going on. But you don't participate to the level and to the extent as these people do. So I'll give you that, because I will give credit where credit is due. Oh, thank you. Okay, well, never mind then. Sorry. So anyway, so she went into my little chat, cherry-picked stuff that she's going to post in her little video, and then just throw this entire temper tantrum, right? And then they went to the Watts family, who at the time, Jamie and some other people that were like close in the case, to the case, were in our Facebook group. And of course, she, of course, then whatever, got to them as well. What's the word I'm looking for? Like, they wanted to warn the Watts, right? Because you know, they don't want the Watts to be victimized by such a horrible person like myself, right? So they went to the Watts, even though Cindy and Jamie Watts are on their hit list. So talk about hypocrisy. And I really hope that this can play, because this is a clip that I was sent that Samantha, Miss Samantha here, sent to another person with regard to the mod chat, right, that they got into. And this is like their little scheming and their little planning, please. I don't know if, let me know if you can hear it. Oh, wait. Can you hear it? Oh, no sound. Damn. Okay, let me see. How about now?
I had a thought. If memory serves correctly, within the last maybe 24 hours or 36 hours, I thought I heard the shit lord himself say that he has something coming out that's going to...
Just a pause. Sorry. I keep stopping it. The shit lord, for your reference, is Armchair Detective. And she's talking about some research that our mods did in the group chat with regards to the investigation of the case and all the stuff that was missed, right? So this is her brilliant plan. Listen.
I had a thought. If memory serves correctly, within the last maybe 24 hours or 36 hours, I thought I heard the shit lord himself say that he has something coming out that's going to be huge and big that DA Rourke doesn't want anybody to know. Now, do you think it's the stuff that in the first recording that you sent me last night where she's talking?
By the way, I see the trolls in the comments. It's okay. Let them have their little tantrums. It just further supports my case here. So thank you.
Talking about due process and everything else, because if that's the case.
Oh, sorry. One more thing. Whenever people resort to name calling, that's when you know that they ain't got shit.
I'm going to beat her to the punch. And I'm going to be putting that out. That's going to be huge and big that DA Rourke doesn't want anybody to know. Now, do you think it's the stuff that in the first recording that you sent me last night where she's talking about due process and everything else? Because if that's the case, I'm going to beat her to the punch. And I'm going to be putting that out before they have a chance to. I would love to do that. Just beat them. You know, I want to unload everything on them, but then I don't, because I want to see how this plays out on your end. We can keep getting more information, but I would love to be able to keep them from pushing another bullshit theory over on Patreon. Do you think that's what that he was talking about?
Okay. Then of course the Grim Reaper Cafe, the ever mysterious justice fighter, justice warrior, is actually good old Samantha.
The man on YouTube who calls himself Armchair Detective. We'd like to ask you why you were banned. All of your friends here at the Grim Reaper Cafe.
You heard her voice, right? Come on.
I'd very much like to speak to you, Alan Vinica. Tell us, Vinica, were you banned again? Can you make another video? Can you go live? Can you go on Patreon? Can you do any of this? Were you banned? Banned. We think you were banned, Vinica. Were you banned? Banned. Do your loyal viewers and your loyal subs know that you were banned, Vinica? Do they know that you've been banned from YouTube again? Tell us, Vinica. Since you're banned, perhaps you cannot make a comment or a video or a live.
All right. So that would be Miss Samantha, a.k.a. the Salty Bitch, a.k.a. the Grimper Cafe, a.k.a. insert any other ones that they have, because they do have more. This is a other one, which that's the channel who was shut down by YouTube, not by me, by YouTube, because it was violating YouTube policies. But no, it would be called fraudulent striking, according to the advocates. I've already had enough of this one. And then, of course, she's in the Honor Network. And she's saying, Frank personally is thanking us for this. Chris, here you are. I'm just outlining that you are part of that group. And as such, I find you intelligent. And in my personal opinion, I think that you're smarter than this. Same goes for these people. I'm not even going to read this, but I'm sure that you guys can find this still, because it is public. let's see. Some more rants. And after all, Frankie Ruthek Jr. says, after all, money is the root of all evil. It sure is. You know who else I think it's all about money for? Well, let me shut up, because that's for another show, because I have more research that I'm holding back on. I believe this is the last slide, but it just outlines and highlights how this cycle is being perpetuated and why it's not stopping. Okay. So it's not the honor network that are the problem. It's certain individuals that are making the honor network, they're making a bad name for them. That's it for the first one. All right, so now I'm going to take a break and just read chat for a minute. I told you this would be a long one. Yeah, it's ridiculous. There's so much more information that I have as part of this research, but it's not even, I think this was just enough. My cigarette went out again. So I've actually reached out to Mr. Posner himself, and he is a very intelligent man and a very approachable man. And I'd asked him, you know, if we're fighting this online harassment and whatever the hell, then can you please explain to me just like anything of how does this work? How do you become a volunteer? Anything. And it doesn't sound like, because I think the family, the families within Honor Network are actually, they actually have work to do. They actually have to find to find all of those hoaxers, right? And they're actually taking their pages down. So they're working full time and they rely on their volunteers to vet the material, the content that is to be stricken and removed. And the problem is there. When you get bad people under the guise of these advocates and volunteers that are breaking every book, not just on YouTube, but just in civil court, even in criminal court, some of the shit that they said. And Helen, Team Phoenix are fab. I'd say the harassment definition fits AD's treatment of NK to a T. Okay, that's your opinion. And guess what? AD is discussing Nicole Kessinger. Yes, I'm not afraid to say her name out loud because she is part of a investigation into a triple homicide. And her name is in the public discovery, and we're all allowed to discuss her and our theories with regards to Nicole Kessinger's involvement or lack thereof in this case. Okay? Thank you. Thank you, Stephanie. Thank you. And okay, here's the thing. I don't want anyone blocked, but if you're going to call people names and argue, like I don't stand for that, because that's literally whatever. So are we ready to go to the next presentation? Because this one will actually go hand in hand with what's quote unquote allowed to be discussed and what isn't allowed to be discussed. All right, well, let's keep moving. So now we're shifting to the case, okay? And what I want to do here is I want to go through all the evidence, well, first of all, some of the evidence that we don't have the results for, and that we never received a follow-up or anything. Sorry, Real Justice, to bore you, but here, this is your time now. This is all for you. All right, so back to the case now. Scene processing. So what I did is I took parts of the discovery that are public domain and not harassment, for those who are in the back and can't hear me. And I went step by step following the evidence, all right? Crime scene report, completed by the Colorado Bureau Investigation. September 13 is the date of the report, and this is from the evidence that they collected from the scene processing. So they looked at Chris's truck. It was parked outdoors in the locked and secured impound, blah, blah, blah. So, all right, scene processing. In the bed of the truck were affixed toolboxes and fuel tanks, hose implements, as well as miscellaneous hand tools, which included a round point shovel, a square point shovel, a sickle, were identified and collected. Also within the bed of the truck was a partially full gas can and fire extinguisher. Located in the front passenger compartment of the truck, a roll of plastic bags was observed and collected from the front passenger side floorboard. The front driver's seat and front passenger seat were covered with canvas seat covers. From the steering wheel, a possible DNA swab was collected. In the rear seat were two plastic bins that contained miscellaneous work, materials, safety equipment, personal items, maps, and paperwork. A pair of black rubber boots were located on the floor behind the front passenger seat. Behind the rear seat were additional miscellaneous tools. Adhesive lifts were collected from the rear seating area and floor. Located in the front passenger side door panel was a green disposable cigarette lighter. And then this is all the stuff that they collected. This is a crime scene. Then we have the blue glove, this one, that was clearly visible on the body cam footage of when they first did the initial search of the house. It was located on top, in the master bedroom. Now, mind you, this could be a second one, but then, you know, we all saw the one that was up by the pillows that was never collected. Okay. And then the book that I believe, I don't know if this book was under Cece's bed or not. Anyways, so it says, the officer says, I collected a light blue nitrile glove that was located on top of the refrigerator in the kitchen. Now, that was 8:15. Right? That was that Wednesday. On 9-4, evidence supervisor Purcell transferred evidentiary items from the Frederick Police Department to the CBI laboratory located in Nevada for lab testing. I transferred custody of these items from myself to Patricia of the CBI lab. Together, I'm assuming this is supposed to be, we verified all items submitted, checking both the item number description, a printed evidence label for accuracy. And so this is the cover letter that she submitted. So you see that it's on the 3rd of September, and she lists all of the evidence that she has turned over to the CBI lab. And that includes the king-size bedding recovered from the trash can, the glove, the plastic trash bags, the fitted sheet recovered from the site, and rake parts. She also handed over the seat covers for the front. Wait, what? Sorry. One second. I just have to. Sorry, guys. One second. Sorry, I apologize. I just had to check something really quick. I don't. Oh, this is frustrating. So, if someone could just please check, or if anyone like of the mods blocked unmasked for any reason, please unblock them. Because I don't see them on the blocked list, so they shouldn't be. But I can't. So yeah, if you could please just look into that. All right. Okay. So let's keep going. So this is the Colorado Bureau of Investigation's request for lab examination. Then on the 4th, So this is 9-3 that the letter was written, and this is 9-4 where the evidence was received. Then also, it should be noted that on 9-4, while running through the evidence submission list with lab tech Patricia Lopez, several items were listed that the CBI lab ultimately did not wish to take possession of at that time. Those items are crossed out on the evidence submission form, which has been added to the case file. The refused items are as follows. And among the refused items, are the driver's seat covers from work truck and the trace lift from the center console and the trace lift from the back seat. I don't know why they were refused, but they were, along with some DNA swabs from the autopsies. And then this is from now September 10th. So this is the 4th and now the 10th. During the week of 9-10, I spoke with lab manager. This is from Baumhover. Regarding the possibility of obtaining Shanann's makeup for comparison with the residue discovered on the bed sheets that were recovered from the kitchen trash can. So Baumhover then ended up calling the Rusecks, asking for the bag back, asking for the makeup bag back, and the Rusecks sent the bag back. But at this point it is, so here, Baumhover says, on September 22nd, he picks up this makeup bag. The crime occurred on August 13th. This is more than a month that this bag has been in the possession of someone other than law enforcement. This is contaminated evidence. What did they do with this makeup bag? It doesn't matter whether or not anyone touched that makeup bag since Shanann. You can't just ask for stuff back after a month and then submit it for forensic testing. I'm pretty sure that the results of that are not going to be valid. Just saying. So here he is with the makeup bag. He's sending it on the 26th of September. He's handing over and asking for the testing. So now here's the results. Okay, so now this is all in September that this was going on. Now, October 1st, this is the stuff that they analyzed. And the glove is number one on the list, but I don't see a lighter on there. So we can deduce that it wasn't tested. The results are 8 Latin prints suitable for comparison were observed or developed on item 7. Item 7 is a black plastic bag. Oh crap, sorry. No Latin prints suitable for comparison were observed or developed on items 8, 10, 13, or 38, which are 8 is a another plastic bag, rake head, whatever else, 13 and 38. 13 is the partial rake and 38 the roll of trash bags. So those did not have anything suitable for comparisons. Item 11 was also not suitable for comparison, and that would be the rake handle. Now, items 71, 72, 81, 82, and 83 were removed from items 7 and 8 and retained in packet whatever, and it was not suitable. Items 6 and 35 will be analyzed at a future date, she says, on October 1st. Now the rest for the Latin 7-1 through 7-8 were entered into the state database and a candidate list was generated for each. Based on these lists, no identifications were made. The Latins were retained and will continue to be searched against new records entered in the database. If an identification is made in the future, the submitting agency, being Frederick Police Department, will be notified. Latin 701 through 708 were suitable for entry into the federal database, which is CODIS, the database with all of the fingerprints of people who were at one point incarcerated, but were not entered into the at this time due to unknown anatomical origin of the friction ridge impressions, right? Clear and complete major case prints to include palm prints, fingerprints, barefoot impressions of Christopher Watts and Shanann Watts, as well as any other party of interest are required for comparisons to be completed. Now, let's go back. If you read Amanda's full report, you see I skipped a page, but that page was the DNA card, the fingerprint card, everything from the autopsy, right? So they have Shanann's fingerprints. They have the girl's fingerprints. They have Chris's fingerprints, because by October 1st, he's been in jail for a while. So his prints would have been in that database that they looked up. But it didn't match Chris Watts' prints. So then they went to the Weld County Jail to get all of these prints from him again. We all remember that. And then on 10th, so this was October 4th. So again, just because my mind functions on dates and stuff. So this is the 1st of October. Then on the 4th, they go back to pick up the rest of the stuff, and everybody and their mom goes with them, like forensic people, Weld County attorney, district attorney's office, public defenders, Frederick police, but everybody's there getting prints from Chris. And Baumhofer says these items will be transferred to the CBI lab at a later date. And that's the 4th. On the 10th, those are transferred to the lab for further comparison. So on the 10th, Amanda took the prints that they took from the Weld County Jail herself to the CBI forensic lab, whatever. She met the evidence technician there and took 6 pieces of evidence from them to take back to the Frederick Police Department. And those items included clothing belonging to Chris Watts and handwritten notes. What Amanda didn't specify, what else was included in this, oh, well, I'm jumping ahead of my time, or of myself, but the results of all of those prints that they got, none. As to the, my conclusion, as to the unidentified print from the crime scene, unknown due to plea deal, according to Frederick Police Department, once Chris pled guilty, all funding for forensic testing stopped. Let that sink in. So when next time someone says, there's no evidence, please explain to me what an unidentified print is doing on Survey 319 that doesn't belong to Chris Watts, the sole perpetrator of this crime. The missing blankets, we hear about them from the second interview when Tammy Lee Coder and Baumhofer went back. Chris said Bella and Celeste each had a blanket with them, and Celeste had a stuffed animal. Chris says he turned to the truck and Cece was first. Celeste had a blue Yankees blanket, and he states that the blue Yankees blanket is the murder weapon. Okay. Blue Yankees blanket is the murder weapon for Bella and Cece. He then says that after the murders, the Yankees blanket was still in his truck and he threw it away. He stopped by a construction dumpster in his neighborhood and threw away his clothes and the Yankees blanket on his way home from work Monday. He keeps extra boots and clothes in his work truck, which he changed into after the murders, is what Chris says, right? We know that Chris is a notorious liar, and those items that he quote unquote disposed of and discarded have never been recovered. So you don't have a murder weapon. Well, you can argue that his hands were the weapon, but nevertheless, he used the blanket as a weapon to constrict or to contribute to the murder. So he's saying he threw it out. They never found it. It was never recovered. This is the blanket. This is Cece with her blanket. Now, go to the 15th of August, or was it the 14th? Whenever they executed the search warrant search. This is the master bedroom. And on the little chairs by the side, up against the wall, you can see the blue Yankees blanket. So obviously, either they didn't collect the murder weapon when they did the search, or Chris is lying. But either way, it doesn't explain what happened. Like, something's off. Catch my drift yet? Don't get me started with this one. All right. Video interview with Nicole Kessinger on August 16th. August 22nd, Kobach met the Thornton Police Department detective, Doug Parker, at the Thornton Police Department. So this is like, I don't know, 16th, like I can't do math, but like a week later, let's say, to pick up the downloaded information from Nicole Kessinger's phone. They found the XRY stuff that I did. I mentioned in the video that I did, and then on the 23rd again, they met in person, where Nicole was asked to surrender her phone for further analysis. and this is a consent forms that Kobach, Mr. Kessinger, Nicole's father, and Nicole Kessinger herself discussed and ultimately signed. And this is when they go back and forth with, like, what are you going to give me? What are we going to give you? You can only have the text messages, and you can only have this. You can have the phone log, you know. So she's at this point thinking that she's got some control, and she's only consenting to these things, right? That's why later on, if you recall the text message that Nicole sent to Kevin Kobach, she asked, how did you get my text messages with Charlotte? Yeah, okay. So this is from the Thornton Police Department then. This is what that Detective Parker actually did. So this is the phone information. They did not extract the SIM card. I don't know why I'm yelling, I'm sorry. So they did an XRY extraction, and it was type logical full. So of course I looked up what that entailed, and it entailed pretty much all of this that we've already seen. Now, this, mind you, that this was taken on the 16th, right? So like 2-3 days after the murders. And don't tell me that you believe that on the 16th, she only had 43 deleted calls on her phone. Do not tell me you believe this, please. Those 43 calls that she deleted were probably from that day, like as she was on her way to meet with them. She's frantically deleting everything. She deleted 35 messages, 8 of which were chat messages, which I don't know what that is. I'm assuming like iMessage. 26 were emails and 1 SMS. Her web browser, self-explanatory. And this is interesting. She has 7 accounts. She has 7 email accounts, okay? And this entire time, throughout all 4 or 5 interviews that she's done, she maintains that she absolutely has no idea. Yet we have proof in front of our eyes that this woman has 7 accounts. This woman is Googling Shannon on Facebook. Now, I don't know about how Facebook works if you, quote unquote, don't have an account. I don't know if you can look at people's posts. But her Cellebrite report clearly indicates that she was on Facebook reading posts about Shanann missing. So clarify, please. So, okay, then on September 10th, Baumhofer took the phones to the lab for analysis. And it was four phones, Carissa's personal, his work phone, Shanann's phone, and NK's phone. Excuse me, Nicole Kessinger's phone. So on the 10th, Baumhofer took that over there, right? On the 17th, here comes Nikki Kessinger via email. And she tells Baumhofer she initially offered to provide her phone records, whatever. And she sent Baumhofer her little typed notes and her little phone bill. And Baumhofer says that there's five separate events that Kessinger calls Watts. And those will be these five separate events that all, interestingly, occur between midnight and 2 a.m. And that's it. Like their last call on this phone number that we know of is August 4th at 2:07, or 14th, sorry. Then she says in her little notes, she starts talking crap. And she talks about Saturday. And she skips from Saturday to Monday. And then she goes from Monday to Tuesday. Then she goes back to Monday. She goes on with Monday. There's no Sunday, conveniently. Conveniently. Right? She does not include her Sunday at all. All right. Bye, bitch. Bye. Helen, it was nice to have you here. Bye. For fuck's sake. All right. So Monday, Sunday's missing, right? Sunday's missing. Now the results. October 3rd, 2 days after the fingerprint, they finish up with this result, with the phone record. So they got the phones on the 10th of September. On the 3rd of October, they send the results from that phone. And this would be from Mr. Derek. Oh, God, what's his name? Derek Ford, I think. So he says, reports were generated from Axiom and Cellebrite. For all submitted items, these reports include numerous sub-reports, which may assist in the review of data. Sub-reports include chats, timeline, context, web-based artifacts, and more. All reports have been provided on CD2. Reports should be reviewed in their entirety. That's what I'm saying, Mr. Ford. I agree with you. We need to send a memo to Mr. Rourke too. So his personal phone, he's taking pictures out on Survey, and he's doing all these Google searches for Instagram accounts, for Oxy, none of which was followed up on at the time of the investigation, which we established. They got this report on October 3rd. Chris didn't plead until, what was it, November 6th or whatever. So, Empeñado's phone was looked at. And that's what she was worried about. And I can answer that question for her. Yes, Bish, yes, they can. They can trace text messages, and they did. Once again, I agree with Mr. Darren Ford. So I would love to review both reports in their entirety, but for some reason they are deemed against public interest. So then he put the CD back into the vault, and he gave one copy. Well, he gave both copies to Detective Prill of the Greeley Police Department. And one of the copies was for Detective Prill, and one was for the Frederick Police Department. Now, let's keep going. So here's 10-2. This is now after Mike Prill picked up the stuff from the lab. He gave this 4 terabyte external hard drive with all of the information that were on the search warrants and the evidence and everything from the phones. So she checked that into the evidence. He also returned the phones that belonged to them. Now, Mike took his, Detective Prill took his copy of the CD and went back to his, this is what I was referring to earlier when Amanda received the phones back. She also received, when she received the handwritten stuff or whatever, she also received the video interview that took place that we've never got, that we never saw, that is allegedly against public interest. However, on the same, in the same token, we have a filmed video interview of Nicole already in the public, as we all know. So I'm not understanding why this particular video interview is against public interest, because that happens to be also the video interview where Nicole Kessinger's father kept interfering with Agent Kobach's questioning. So then here's Detective Prill's investigation. So he's the one that did the 50-page timeline, right? That's the one that we always look at. So here's his involvement. On August 22nd, the FPD and the Weld County District Attorney's Office formally requested my assistance with the homicide investigation. Their request was granted. So where do we see this request, and who granted this request? That's my question. August 24th, he met with Baumhofer and Michael Rourke and Rob Miller, and they decided that his endeavor would begin with the organization of the investigation while simultaneously identifying any and all necessary follow-up investigation. On August 29th, he attended a briefing. On September 6th, he assisted Baumhofer with writing the search warrants for the phones. And then also, let's see, also that day, Baumhofer interviewed a woman claiming to have had an affair with Chris Watts. With a change in our recording equipment at the Greeley Police Department, it took several weeks to eventually download and preserve the recorded interview. But nevertheless, we have it. As difficult as it was for them to preserve and download those interviews, we have them. Beginning on September 18th, he began his review of an organization. On October 2nd, he met with Darren Ford at the forensic lab and signed the evidence receipt, picked up the phones. He collected all of those CDs. That's right. Like, we already went over that. Now, October 5th, I preserved Watts' name summary report and inmate data from the county jail. That's when he took the booking photographs. And then on October 11th, they had a meeting with Baumhofer and members of the prosecution, and collectively they identified a myriad of topics requiring attention during future follow-up investigation in this matter. What would that myriad of topics requiring attention consist of? Because at this point, it's October 11th, and now we're less than a month away from Chris pleading guilty, and a myriad of topics that require attention for future investigation certainly can't all be explored in a short 2 weeks or 3 weeks. Investigation continues. Please forward to the district's attorney's office. Then on the 30th, this is October 30th, 7 days before the plea deal. 7 days before the plea deal. Let me say it again. 7 days before the plea deal, Detective Prill comes up with his analysis of the phone. During his review of the data, certain information was learned. Agent Darren Ford conducted a logical extraction of data from these phones. In conversations with Ford, he advised that the lab does not possess technology to perform physical data extractions from Apple devices. Thus, I discovered the extracted data is not inclusive of all data stored amongst the assorted applications within a given device. Now, why this waited until the 30th, I believe, is because they got those search warrants and they needed to wait for them. Anyways, so in mid-July, Watts began transferring images from his camera application into the secret calculator app. This activity is not reflected within the phone's timeline. Locating those transferred images proved challenging. Okay, let me just get to the point. In the near future, a follow-up warrant will be sought to manually search through this phone and access the secret calculator. That search will include any additional photographs or videos, any browser activity, and information related to the installation date. Amongst the other installed applications found on this phone, I suggest that same warrant seek permission to manually inspect the alarm clock, Apple Watch, and Vivint applications. So then he talks about what he used in his review. This is a little bit off, but it's okay. So he says he made that 50-page document, and there's ancillary information that directs you to the specific location within the Cellebrite report files. That information is highlighted with box brackets. Okay, so he's saying that everything that he got from that is from the Cellebrite report files. Okay, and he's telling you how to read it and how to find it, were you to look for it yourself. So then October 9th and 10th, this is what he was talking about here, is they put in for the search warrant. So my conclusion for Prill, like he only looked at the Cellebrite report files. There, what about all the stuff that the search warrants returned? Okay, I don't even remember what. Oh, that's right. Okay, so this one is from the 14th. Now this is a CBI agent, and she responded to help with the analytical assistance during a missing persons investigation. So she says that she received on the 15th a copy of the Cellebrite phone dump that was done by the Kono Police Department on Chris Watts' personal phone. Like the other phones, Agent Kevin Hoyland and I came to the agreement that I would analyze the content and he would analyze the phone tolls. Throughout the next several weeks, I started building a timeline on I2 analyst, whatever. So she's talking about the timeline. On 9/11, it was determined that another investigation would complete the timeline in another software that is more easily shared with the group. My work on the timeline ceased at this point. So she was taken off the timeline on September 11th, and she already had Cellebrite reports, and that is how they probably found Nicole Kessinger. The information that she used in her phone analysis is all of this. So you can see that number 13 on the list is Chris's personal phone, Cellebrite. That's one file, that's one report, that's one point of information. What about all this other stuff? Did Detective Michael Prill also use all of these attachments that Agent Danley or whatever used in hers? No, because Prill only used Cellebrite reports that he got for Chris, Nicole, and Shanann. There was no analysis of historical details, incoming, outgoing, cell sites, cell phone tower, all of that stuff that they got back as a result of the warrant that they submitted to AT&T, Verizon, and all of that was never looked at or used in a report. That's why I don't understand. I'll reserve my comments. Then here I was working on the timeline as well, where it doesn't really add up. Let me just give me 1 second. I just need to check something. I'm gonna take this off for a sec to see. And I feel like, my God, there's just so much. I told you I'd be tired by now. Because we've already like talked about this over and over and over again. And like the next couple of slides, I go over all the interviews that they did with NK. And let me see here. What is this? Oh, she says that on August 12th. So now, mind you, this interview, on the 21st, well, hold on. Before I start yelling again, let's just go back. So first she had the interview in the park with her dad and the FBI and Duke the dog, where she said that she only went to his house once, where she doesn't remember anything. Then the next day she meets with Kobach and Agent Martinez. And she talks about, Kobach says, I noted Nicole was very tired during the interview and she reported she had very little sleep over the past few days. The following is a synopsis of the interview with Nicole. For complete record of the interview, refer to the audio or video recording. We would love to, Kobach, but... Also, transcripts for this interview were requested. Prior to the interview, Nicole provided me with items of clothing that belonged to Chris Watts that she no longer wanted in her house or home. Nicole also provided me with handwritten notes. Those items were booked into evidence at the CBI Lakewood office. On August 17th, I was going to play a clip, but right now I can't listen to her voice. So... On the 17th, she met again, or they talked on the phone. And during this call, she says that she remembers FaceTiming Chris. And during the video call, Chris was laying on a mattress that did not have sheets on it. Chris said he was cleaning his home and trying to keep busy to keep his mind off of things. Nicole said she asked him why the bed did not have sheets on it, and Chris told her that he had washed the sheets. Then she also mentions, interestingly, where is it? Oh yeah, she says that Nicole Atkinson's son was running around the house and that there's some stuff missing, and that Chris said that the blankets were missing from the kids' rooms. And Nicole asked if Nicole Atkinson took them, and Chris said no. Nicole Atkinson didn't take the blankets. That he believed Shanann took the blankets. And this is on the 17th. And I want to remind you that this is 3 days after the murders. At this point, nobody other than law enforcement and the coroner's office knew about anything to do with bed sheets or blankets for that matter. So the fact that she's bringing this up out of nowhere, that she conveniently remembered after she damage controlled the shit out of her story with her dad, she's assisting the investigation by providing crucial information about the murder weapon, the crime scene, evidence that was recovered from the crime scene. And you're telling me that this is what they talked about on FaceTime. Come on, come on. Give me a break. Give me a break. On the 21st, the third interview, at this point, Kovac's probably like, get her away from me. During this one, she talks about Chris usually comes in the office, so she thought it was weird that his wife went missing, or she thought it was ironic, while like on that one day that he wasn't at the office. So of course, like she's saying, this is when she asked him to send her text messages to prove that he was at the site. Where are those text messages, Nicole Kessinger, Detective Prill, Mr. Rourke, anyone. I'm not taking her word for it, please. Oh, God. See, I can't. And then she goes into detail about all the stuff that Nick had to do. At this point, again, nobody but the law enforcement people knew about anything about, law enforcement didn't even know that Chris was sending her pictures at this point. Like, they know nothing. They hadn't even looked at the phone by this at this point. Remember, because they started looking at it in October. I'm yelling again. So here she talks again about laying on a mattress with no sheets on it. And she didn't know what bed it was, but it didn't look like it was his makeshift basement bedroom. And that the mattress could have been blue in color. And if I recall correctly, I think Cece's mattress is blue. So again, she's naming stuff that she should not be knowing. And for someone who can't remember a 111-minute phone conversation the night of and the morning of the murders, you clearly can remember irrelevant details about irrelevant items, seemingly, that are in no way related to the crime, right? Okay, yeah. And then finally, on the 23rd, that's the interview that we saw. She finally went into the CBI, and that was a whole cluster F, and I'm not even going to look into that. But then finally, they took her phone. And then she was, of course, worried about talking to her friends about damage control, relating to her name getting out of the media. So that's another thing. I can't believe that someone is concerned about damage controlling their reputation in the media because the married man you chose to have an affair with annihilated his family, probably, in my opinion, with your help and with your encouragement. You have the balls to sit and look this man in the eye and say that you're worried about damage control. All right, the disposable lighter that was collected from Chris's work truck was never tested or mentioned in the forensic analysis result. Who smokes in the Watts circle and would have access to his work truck? Who smokes in the Watts circle and would have access to his basement? The answer to these questions will reveal who was there that night and that morning, and how the lighter made it from the basement to the passenger side of the truck. This just keeps going on and on. So I messaged Amanda and I asked her, the letter that I got from Chief of Police, I would like to have an official, like, written statement of the grounds why it was denied, because simply stating that it's against public interest does not satisfy this particular code that they cited. And then I asked her, you know, we didn't receive any of this other stuff. Like, what's up with that? And Amanda is usually very nice, and she gets back to people relatively quickly. And she did so in this case immediately this morning. She says, all items requested and in the possession of the Frederick Police Department have been released. Please forward any further correspondence to the Weldcon. So I said, all right, sure. Can you give me an email for him, please? Because I tried since January and he's not getting back to me. And conveniently, I haven't heard back from Amanda either. So the next step is the formal appeal that I will be sending to the 19th Judicial District Court judge, whoever it is. And then we'll take it from there. Because these questions need to be answered. And that, and if Chris is thinking about an appeal, I sure as hell hope he gets it. Because an unidentified print at the crime scene, you've got to be kidding me. So I don't even know. I've talked way too much. I need to shut up now. But the reason why I focused on the lighter is for this reason. I was looking at Officer Coonrod's footage, like a body cam footage, from the very, very first day that they went to the house, like the 13th. And if you remember, he did like an initial sweep of the house. He looked for any signs of anyone. And on the body cam, I noticed this. One second. One second, I'm looking for it. Okay. I noticed this. And that to me looks like a pack of menthol cigarettes sitting on top of a green metallic ashtray in the basement next to the bed by the basement window. So find a smoker and you'll find a story, I promise. And I'm gonna shut up for now because I've been yelling for, what, 2 hours almost. So thank you for listening to me rant, but yeah, so that's my two presentations. It's a lot of information. It looks like Newports to me because I smoke Newports. So I was like, oh, hey, a cigarette. And I'm like, wait a minute. That's the only reason why I noticed it. So that's my stuff, and I'm officially done ranting now, and thank you for listening. Sorry for any feelings that were hurt, but you're all adults, and I'm sure you can deal with it. Oh, crap, did I just get out of the thing? Yes, I did. That was not very smart, but let me put the picture back up so you can better get a better look at it. What is this? Yeah. I don't know if I can make it bigger. Yeah, I can. Perfect. So that's just like a screenshot that I took of the video. And I added the timestamp on the video so you know how to look for it. So that a victim's advocates don't say that I photoshopped my pack of cigarettes on there. I don't know anything about who smokes. So that's no point. I don't know who smokes, who doesn't smoke. I don't know anything. But it's quite interesting, right? Diamond Girl says those look like an earthy brand of cigarettes. I'm sure I forgot something because, like I said, I mean, it's a lot. And I was trying to be politically correct and not hurt feelings. And ultimately, I said, you know what? Screw it. Like, I'm not, I don't know. Like, it's about transparency, right? Everything is about transparency. So if you have the balls to put stuff out there in the public forum, then you take those same balls and that same energy that you had when you were putting that up there to take responsibility for what you said. So that's my comment on the first presentation. This one is just whatever. I don't even know. So that's it. And I think I have a couple of videos that I have made that I'll be releasing eventually, God knows when. But I'll be probably like taking a break from this. Like, I won't be making videos about the Watts case until we figure out what happens with this appeal, because I'm pretty sure that wouldn't help us if we just put all of our arguments out there. So I've already started writing it. It's I still need to add to it and need to, I don't know, just we're all doing research on legal stuff. So we'll be keeping you informed about that. The thing next to it looks like a book, maybe, with like an envelope on top of it or something. But the ashtray and the cigarettes are clear as day, like clear as day. So the fact that they have a lighter with no owner and no smoker, and then a pack of cigarettes. And then again, I don't know if the Rusek smoke, because I know they used to live in the basement for a while with them, but I don't know how long it had been since they had moved out at this point, because we know that Chris cleaned the basement because Detective Prill was very kind to let us know that he took pictures before and after. And I don't know, like, cigarettes dry out once you open the pack, so I don't know that like they would be saving them there with an ashtray, like with cigarette butts in it, for the next time they come to town, the Rusek's come to town, or whoever smokes comes to town, you know. So I don't know, just odd. And then that's it, for real. I'm done. I'm reading comments now. For any questions that you guys might have. Yeah, Bosnian Gypsy. Woo. I actually do have a Gypsy tattoo. And the reason why I have the Gypsy tattoo is because, unlike the racist people who talk about gypsies being con men and beggars and stealers, whatever, that's not the only stereotype. That's not the only stereotype that belongs to the gypsies. Gypsies are nomadic. They have no roots. They're everywhere. And the only thing that they have with them, that they take with them to everywhere they go, is their music and their culture. And the entire Balkan Peninsula, the music is influenced by gypsies and by Middle Eastern Oriental kind of sounds. And all of that was brought to us by nomads, by travelers, by people who don't belong anywhere, the underdog, if you will. So how about we honor them, or not just them, any group. Out of here with that BS. I can't believe so either. Cindy Surfer says she can't believe that they didn't look at the same. And I looked at the dog body cam footage as well, when they went down there with the dogs. And it appears it's not as clear as here, but it appears as though it's still there because I wanted to see if Chris had moved it, because that would have been even more incriminating, but he didn't. So, but still, it's still interesting. All right, well, that's my rant for now. I'm literally sweating nasty and I need to go. But I dumped a lot of information on you guys. So I'm looking forward to hearing your thoughts about it and your comments. Like I said, we've been doing research in our group for a long time and we have like so much stuff that this isn't even like the beginning of it. And the reason why I outlined just the phone stuff and the DNA stuff is because it's the strongest points that Chris would have if he were to pursue an appeal, which in my opinion, he should regardless, because you know, I won't give you the statistics, but I talked about it in a previous video that a lot of convictions, most of convictions go to appellate court. So, but yeah, so let it all sink in. Thank you for listening. Thank you for putting up with like the disruptors or whatever, because I saw a few comments being removed. I didn't get a chance to read all, but I will go back and read. Thank you for everything. Thank you to my mods. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And yeah, I didn't do a live for a long time because, well, like I said in the beginning, I had some like personal stuff going on, but also because there's just so much information. Like I just needed to sit in it and process and stew in it. And it doesn't matter how long I thought about it and what different angles I thought about it from, and you know, it didn't matter because ultimately, like the conclusion was the same. Like this was a botched investigation, and whether or not Chris did it, it doesn't matter. He still deserves due diligence God, I can't even think of words anymore. Like he's entitled to see what evidence prosecution has collected that is incriminating, but he's also entitled to see any evidence that the prosecution has collected that would be exculpatory, that would prove, in other words, that he is not the perpetrator of one or more of the charges that he was convicted of, right? So he's entitled to that. And I don't know what he's doing. I don't know if he's, well, you know, I don't have contact with him, but I sure hope that he is looking at this stuff. Because that's the only way that all of this harassment, all of this BS is going to end, is if someone starts talking. Thank you. So, oh my God, Cher, thank you. Thank you, Beth, for the super chat. Thank you so much. Real Justice, that's right. I contacted Real Justice as well because he is very, very good at reading statutes and stuff like that. So we've been sharing some information as well, which I appreciate that, Real Justice. So yeah, that's pretty much it's a group effort, really. Like it's a group effort. And yeah, that's it. And then I'm gonna get off here now and just look for your comments and your reactions, and hopefully we'll chat soon again. Thank you, Jan. Thank you. All right, that's it for me. Have a good rest of your Monday, guys. See you around.